Welcome to North Dallas Church. My name is Pastor Vic Garcia. I'm the pastor here. And I'm so grateful that you guys made it in this morning. It's great to see you guys this morning. Thank you for being here. You know, last week I didn't have a chance. Thank you, Abraham. Last week I didn't have a chance to go through my message. And I'm just kind of go over it. I have a little bit of time this morning, and I'm so happy for that, actually. And so turn with me real quick to Hebrews 12:15. You can play a little bit. Yeah, that's fine. Hebrews 12:15 in the NLT, it says, look after each other so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Watch out that no poisonous root of bitterness grows to trouble you. Now, bitterness is a real thing, right? It can get into your heart and it can start to mess up some serious stuff. I remember, you know, whenever I was in junior high school, you can actually stop, that's fine, bro. When I was in junior high school, I had a coach. Has anybody ever been told a statement in your life where you remember the statement, like, even today? Like, so I was in junior high, right? And I was in seventh grade, and I was a lot skinnier than I am today, right? If I was in junior high, this jacket probably would close on me, Sean, right? Close, but today it's not closing. And I remember I used to be a very, very fast runner. I used to be able to run. I participated in all the sports. I was in football. I was a running back and the tailback, wide receiver, and I played both sides. I played safety and the D end. And then in basketball, I was I was a shooting guard, and I was number three in the state in three-point percentage. That is not the case today, as Gary can probably attest, and my friend Carlos and Ms. Kim, we went to go play basketball. And it's real, y'all. When you hit 40 years old, I've heard everybody say, man, when you hit 40, things change. And let me tell you, they do change, because I was no good that day. And I'm just barely getting the feelings back in my legs. But I just didn't have anything under me. When I would shoot, I would have nothing under me. I was airballing the ball. I was coming up short. I was hitting the rim. Meanwhile, Gary's over there showing out, going between his legs, dunking. And I'm just like, okay, sir, you know, you don't have to do all that. But I remember my coach saying, he said, Vic, you're really fast. You're really, really good. You have a lot of potential. And I was sitting there, and I was just like, man, that's awesome. I'm so happy that my coach is you know, speaking good things over me right now and encouraging me. And a split second after that, he said, now let me tell you what potential means. And I'm like, okay. And I'm not going to use the word because it's a bad word, but he says, it means you're now. Means you're really crappy now, right? And I just said to myself, wow. And for the rest of my life, even till today, anytime somebody says, oh, Vic, you got a lot of potential on that keyboard. Thank you. I can't stand you right now. Don't tell me that ever again. I have potential. But every time I hear the word say potential, it just brings me back. And I believe that because he said that to me, there was a beginning to be a root of bitterness inside of me. And it was not a very pleasant feeling to know that my coach was not speaking very, very kind things over me. It's real similar to the holiday season. During the holidays, you might have some family members, or maybe if you're from out of town, you have to go back to the town that you're from, and you have to see maybe some family members or a friend that maybe you don't want to see because that person really, you know, bothered you, it really kind of makes you mad. That's bitterness. And that happens to me still today. You know, I don't want to go back to to like maybe say Amarillo or even Kansas and be like, man, I really don't want to see that person because there's a lot of bitterness because there was I went through something with them. And I tell you what, if you allow that to continue to be in your heart, it's going to be something really tough for you to overcome. I've even done it to where I'm saying, wow, I know that person's going to be there. And I'll say, oh, you know what? So-and-so invited me over to their house. I can't make it. I can't make it over there. I'm so sorry. But I really appreciate the invite. That has happened to me so many times. And I just want you to know this morning that that is not the way that God wants you to be. That's not the way that God wants me to be. That's not the way that God wants you to be. That's not what he created us, how he created us to be. The thing that you have to remember the most is that when you do have bitterness in your heart, you have to do your very, very best to go and forgive that person. Say, hey, man, you know what? I missed it. I'm sorry that I acted that way. I'm sorry that I treated you that way. I'm sorry that I said those awful things to you. That's not really what I meant. In the heat of the moment, that's probably what I meant. But right now, I'm in my, I guess, my right frame of mind, and I apologize for saying that. When you see or come across a bitter person or even yourself, you tend to sometimes feel like sympathy towards them, or you begin to kind of feel sympathy for yourself. Well, oh, well, I can't believe this person doesn't, you know, is not understanding where I'm coming from. And it's important that when you start to feel that way, that we just pray to God and we ask God to help us. Help us break that, because that is a really bad, it's like bondage, man, because when you have bitterness in your heart starts to harden towards that person, towards the people that, you know, like in high school, you used to have a clique of some friends, and if one person got in an argument with another person, man, that whole clique would be mad at them. Boy, if you're mad at my friend, I'm mad at your friend. I'm mad with them. We're all going to be mad at you. And that's really the wrong attitude to have. Ephesians 4:31, it says, get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander. I'm going to say that again. Get rid of all bitterness, rage, anger, harsh words, and slander, as well as all types of evil behavior. Instead, be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving, as God has forgiven you. Now, that's super easier said than done, right? Way easier said than done. Because when you're bitter, when somebody has not treated you right, or when somebody has really done you wrong for, I mean, it could be a million reasons, you're going to have rage. You're going to have anger. You're probably going to say some really bad words to them. You're going to have evil behavior, like, I'm going to slit your tires, or I'm going to bust the windows out your car. You know, there's a song that says, I'm going to bust the windows out your car. And there's a person in our church that's kind of crazy like that. I'm not going to say who it is, but never mind. It's funny. Y'all missed it. Bitterness is like a seed that root that goes into the heart. And when it springs up, it's going to do a lot of different things. When it springs up, it starts to affect the people around you, your friends, your close ones, your wife or your husband, maybe your spouse, your colleagues. And you tend to start to have a really defensive attitude. And I say that because it's me, y'all. I used to be like that. And it was something that God really had to fix in my heart, because I didn't want to, man, there was a time in my life, and I'll just tell you, when I went through my divorce, it was a very difficult time in my life because I had a lot of my friends that were my friends first. It was like, Christian, she's my friend. She's my friend first, right? Her and I are friends. And then I get married, and here comes my wife. Oh, well, now they're friends, right? But whenever I got divorced, it seemed like my friends that were my friends first kind of took my ex-wife's side. And I felt, honestly, I felt alone. I felt betrayed. None of my friends, like, I didn't feel like I could trust them, because When I first started going through that, it was something where I would talk to them and be like, yo, man, this is what's happening with my ex-wife. She's saying this, she's saying that. And then they would go back and tell her and I would find out. So it became to where it was just like I couldn't talk to nobody anymore. I couldn't even visit with my own family anymore because I felt like they were kind of in on it. And later I found out they weren't, but I started to become super, super bitter. And I started to become very snappy with people, and I didn't treat them right. But it's like, to me, bitterness is like a venomous snake. If you get bit by that snake, it's going to be just a matter of time before things start to really collapse in your life. And, you know, that's what happened to me. Bitterness came inside of me. Slowly started, things started to fall apart for me. I lost my family. I lost my business. I had to go work a job that I did not like. And things just, my credit went like this. My cars got repossessed. And it was a really humbling season. And I said to myself, Lord, why in the world would you let something like that happen to me? I grew up in church. My parents were pastors. I moved to Amarillo. I served my father. I've been going to this church. I've been in church my entire life. Why in the world would you allow me to go through something like this? And he said this to me. He says, because I am not your focus. I am not your focus. And whenever I heard him say that, I learned that if I don't put God first in my life, it doesn't matter how many businesses I own. It doesn't matter like how many friends I have or lose or whatever. I'm always going to have the short end of the stick whenever I don't put God first. 1 John chapter 2, verse 9 says, anyone who claims to be in the light but hates a brother or sister is still in darkness. Anyone who loves their brother and sister lives in the light. And there is nothing in them to make them stumble. But anyone who hates a brother or sister is in the darkness. They do not know where they are going because the darkness has blinded them. I was blind. I wasn't able to see clearly. I wasn't able to focus. I wasn't able to understand the people that were there to help me and not to bring me down. And it's also a part of the process of saying, God, if I really do trust you, I really do need for you to bring me out of this thing. As bitterness, as it progresses, it can cause spiritual paralysis. You stop talking to God. I stopped talking to God. I was behind that piano in Amarillo, playing every single week, but I wasn't talking to God. It was the motion. Got to get up. Got to go to church Sunday morning. I got to go to rehearsal Thursday night. I got to go to church Wednesday night. That was the routine. But really, man, I was checked out. There was nothing. I was just doing it for the motion, man. I was just doing it because it was something that I had to do. But I tell you this. I tell my guys this. If you go through that, I understand. It's okay. Because you only really need one word from God to change your life. Only one. And even though I was playing, not really my heart being there, even though I was doing that, even though I wasn't doing it because I was bitter, eventually God started chipping away at my heart. It's kind of like when you cut down a tree. If you've ever cut down a tree, not with the saw, not with an electric saw that has gas in it, Christian. I'm talking about a real one, like with the axe. Now, I've never done it, but I've seen some of my friends that are in the country that they've done it, and it's hard work. But it doesn't happen like that, right? And God's process in my heart wasn't like that. It took time. I allowed him to come in little by little. I allowed him to soften my heart little by little. And when I tell y'all that my wife probably was the most influential person before she became my wife, I honestly believe that that's the reason I'm standing here today alive, because I was such in a deep depression. I was so bitter that I was on my way to actually commit suicide. And all of my friends that I called wouldn't pick up the phone. They weren't answering. I'd call them, they weren't answering. I called Joy, she answered, she prayed for me. And slowly but surely, it started changing my life. She started speaking positive things into me. And I'm so grateful that she did that, because that's when I started to say to myself, I can get better. I can allow this bitterness to go away. I can start opening up my heart so God can start working in me again. Hebrews 12:15, again, it says, look after one another so that none of you fails to receive the grace of God. Do you have people around you right now that you know you can call and say, hey, man, I know these guys are going to pray for me. I know these guys are going to lift me up. I know these guys are going to speak positive things into my life. See, because when you don't do that and you really don't seek God anymore, God starts to remove the favor over your life. And then you're out on your own. And here you are trying to open a door. And you may finally open it, but you don't have the character or the integrity to keep you there. And see, that's the key. You have to be in relationship with God so that God can continue to do amazing things in your life. When that stuff happened to me, I could tell the grace, it was gone for me. There wasn't anything that you could have told me that would have said, hey, you know what? God loves you. You know, God believes in you. He trusts you. No, man, I was out doing the opposite. I was out at the club. I was out drinking. I was out partying. I was out spending all kinds of money. And it was ridiculous. And I didn't gain anything from it. I want you to go to Romans 15, if you're following along. If not, it's on the screen. As he says, we who are strong must be considerate of those who are sensitive about things like this. We should help others to do what is right and build them up in the Lord. Are you considerate about what's happening around you? Because here's the deal. Here's the most important part, is that you might be the only church that they see every day. So how does your walk with God express to your colleagues or to your friends or to your spouse, boyfriend or girlfriend, however? How are you doing that? Because it says here in Romans, it says, and I'll read it again, we who are strong must be considerate of those pretty much who are not. You know, when you have it going on, when everything is going right, right? When you have a good job, when you're making decent money, when you're able to pay all your bills on time, you know, because I used to pay all my bills, but it was very sporadic. I had to choose, you know, I had a budget, and then I said, which are the most important ones? They eventually all got paid, but they were paid late. But when you have it going on, right, when God's blessed you and you can pay your bills on time and you can have extra money and disposable money, are you able to say to yourself, you know what, God's really blessed me. I see that my friend is struggling over here. I'm going to really help him out with some stuff. You know, because if you're not doing that, you should. We should help others to do what is right and build them up in the Lord. When you know, my wife is one of the best people. If you need an encouraging word, or if you need somebody to just lift you up, pray with you, I strongly suggest that you call her. I strongly suggest that you make time to visit with her, that you grab her by the arm and pull her to the side and say, will you just pray for me? Because she is such an encourager. She encourages me every single day, even when I feel like, man, I don't know what I'm doing. She might not have all the answers, but she knows how to pray. The anti-venom for bitterness is forgiveness. If you're writing stuff down, I want you to write this. Obeying the word of God is not a matter of emotions, but a matter of simply obeying. See, it's not deep. The Bible says that obedience is better than sacrifice, right? And if you put yourself in position to where you obey what God wants us to do, and a lot of times pastors or preachers or evangelists, they'll stick that and they'll put it to money, but it's not even about that. It's about obeying what God has asked you to do. What has God asked you to do that you know in your heart, man, I know that God has called me to do this. Now, you have that in your mind. How are you honoring God by what he has placed in your heart to do? How are you honoring God? Are you obeying God? Are you saying to yourself, you know what? Yeah, I think that I'm obeying God with what I'm supposed to be doing right now. Or is it the total opposite? 2 John verse 1 says, and this is love, that we walk in obedience to his commandments. As you have heard from the beginning, his command is that you walk in love. Now, we're not always going to feel like walking in love. There are times when my wife and I, we are at each other's throat over where are we going to go eat. In about 15 minutes, I'm going to ask my wife, honey, where do you want to go eat? She'd be like, I don't know. Where do you want to go? Oh, baby, what do you want to eat? Oh, well, whatever is fine. Let's go eat Chinese. Ooh, no, I don't want Chinese. Has anybody ever had that fight before? Anybody? No, just two people? Never? Sean, never? Abraham? But lucky for her, I already got that on lock, so we already know where we're going. There won't be no fighting today. But you got to walk in love. Abraham, you can go ahead and come up. That's one of the hardest things to do if you have a bitter heart. Let's just be honest, right? When you know somebody has done you wrong, honestly, if I could just be super, super upfront with y'all, when I know I got to go see my ex-wife, when I know I have to go see her because I'm seeing my kids, it's not very pleasant, right? It's not an exciting thing to do. Like, oh my gosh, I can't wait. Yes, I get to go see her. No. Sir, it is not like that. But I got to walk in love. Even though we're not together no more, she's still the mother of my children. I still got to respect her, right? And when I see her, I'll be like, hey, you know, how are you doing? How are things going? How's Nick, her new husband? How is he? Everything's going good. Yes, we're cordial to one another, right? And it makes it easier. I get in the car and how many of y'all ever done this? You get in the car when you finally see somebody and everything went good. You can sit in your car and you go, that kind of happens. But if you're not walking in love, you really need to ask God to soften your heart a little bit. It's not hard to do. It maybe takes a little bit of swallowing your pride. But it reminds me of the story of Joseph, and we just preached about this. Think about Joseph. Joseph was hated by his brothers. They sold him to be a slave. He was falsely accused of sexual abuse by his master's wife. And he went to jail for it. He was betrayed and forgotten by the person who promised him to speak on his behalf, so he could get out of jail. And he went through all of that, and he guarded his heart, and he didn't allow bitterness to come in. Of course, we all know the story. After a lot of years that passed, Joseph had to face his brothers. He knew it was his brothers, but his brothers didn't know he was Joseph. They didn't know that was him. And the Bible says that whenever they seen him, whenever he finally said, I am Joseph, the Bible says in Genesis 45, it says, don't be upset and don't be angry with yourselves for selling me to this place. It was God who sent me here ahead of you to preserve your lives. This famine has raged the land for 2 years and will be for five more, and there will be neither plowing nor harvesting. That's what he told those guys. If somebody like Joseph can go through everything that he went through, surely we can say, hey, please forgive me for treating you bad. Please forgive me for speaking those really awful things over your life. That's what Joseph did. Joseph had every right to be very angry at his brothers. Every right. They earned it. They earned it. But he didn't. He chose to walk in love. He chose to say, don't be mad at yourselves. God sent me here. Can you believe that? How many of y'all think you can do that today? It is very hard to do. And it's only when you can guard your heart and do not allow bitterness to come root. Romans 8:28, we all know this verse, and says, and we all know that all things work together for the good to those who love him and have been called according to his purpose. You see, everything that you've been through in life, the good stuff, the really awesome stuff, the graduating, the passing the degree, the achieving the promotion, everything, all that stuff, children, all of it, all that stuff is good. But even also all the bad stuff, the divorce, the people talking behind your back, the people that don't honor you, all those things, you are still supposed to go through that. But you got to understand, don't allow bitterness to get into your heart to where you can't function anymore. Because when you allow, and I say this because it happened to me, when you allow bitterness in your heart, man, everything is so uncomfortable. It's like where it would be like me trying to button this top button, y'all. If I were to do that, guess what would happen? I'd probably start choking. I probably wouldn't be able to breathe. I sure as heck couldn't swallow any good food. All because I chose to button this top button. This could be bitterness. Choose not to do that this morning. From this day forward, choose to love your neighbor. Choose to love your spouse. Choose to love that person at your job that maybe you don't care very much about. Choose to love all those people. Honor them. Treat them well. Even though they don't might not treat you well, buy them lunch. Say, hey, you know what? I'm going to run over to whatever, Chick-fil-A. Can I grab you anything? What? I did that one time to this guy that really didn't treat me that well. And I said to myself, you know what? I'm going to honor him. He don't deserve it, but I'm going to honor him anyway. And I asked him, yo, I'm going to go grab something to eat. Can I get you something? Startled him. He's like, no, I'm good. I was like, no, man, really. I mean, even a soda or something. I went an extra little bit. He's like, yeah, man, I'll take a soda. You know, when I did that, when I brought that back, time after time, it started to get a lot better. We started to have a good relationship. We're not like best friends. We don't go hang out. We don't, you know, we don't do any of that stuff together, but we're on the same kind of field right now. We understand each other and we're kind to one another. It took a lot for me to do that, y'all. And if it's a lot for you, just ask God. Just stand to your feet this morning. If you have allowed bitterness to get into your heart and you're ready to make a change and you're ready to say, God, I really need your help on this one. Lord, you took me out of this one over here. And it was kind of easy. But man, Lord, I really need your help on this one. Because this one is going to take a whole lot for me to get over. And the way that you speak to God, it doesn't have to be real, I guess, religious. Or there's no perfect way to do it. Just how you speak to your spouse or to your neighbor or whatever. That's how I speak to God. In the same way that I speak to Joy, and I just say, Father, man, I don't know what I did to miss it. I don't know how I missed it again. Lord, I don't want this bitterness to come into my heart. Lord, I need this bitterness to go away. Father, I want to get along with my spouse. I want to get along with my coworker. I need things to start going right for me. Those kind of conversations is all you really got to have. So with every head bowed this morning, I don't know if you're struggling with any of that this morning, but if you are, just shoot your hand up real quick. We're just going to pray over you right there where you're at. You don't even have to come up. I see your hand. Lord, I just pray that you give us the boldness to come to you, Father, and say, help me with this. Rid me of this bitterness in my heart. Soften my heart. Allow me to forgive. Allow me to walk up to the person and say, I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And you might say this morning, but it wasn't even my fault. I didn't even do anything. That's okay. You didn't have to be the one that did something. You just have to be the person with higher integrity, with higher character, with higher purpose. And if you truly believe God can change that situation around, if you can really believe it in your heart, then he will. He'll give you the boldness. He'll give you the know-how or the know what to say when you walk up to that person. And Father, I pray right now, Lord, that they have the boldness to walk up to that situation, Father. Whether it's a person, it's a situation that maybe doesn't involve anybody, Father. I pray that you increase their faith this morning, Lord. That you increase it so much that you give them the boldness to walk up, to change the situation, and to change the atmosphere, Father. Because I know all we got to do is just call on your name, and you will be there. You will start to transform the hearts of people. You will intervene in every situation. I pray for the person in this building right now. I just feel it in my heart that you have a huge financial mountain in front of you. It's so big that you say to yourself, man, I don't even know where to start. God has heard your cry. And he says, trust me. He said, trust me. Father, speak to us. Speak to our hearts this morning, Lord. Father, we're open to hear your voice. God, I thank you. I thank you for sending people into our lives, Father. I thank you for giving us the boldness to open our hearts to you, Lord, and allow us to walk through, Father, that bitterness, Lord, that may be in our heart, God. And I thank you, Father, that you're going to start orchestrating things that we can't even see or understand. And Lord, I just pray that it be an easy thing. That financial burden, I pray that it's an easy thing, Father, for them to overcome. And a lot of times, Lord, it just comes through obedience, Father. Allow us to be more obedient to what you have called us to do, Lord. Allow us to hear your voice more clearly, Father. Help us to be around people that will lift us up, that will speak positive things into our life, Father. And God, I just praise you and I thank you, Father. In your name we pray. And the church said, amen. Well, give the Lord a hand of praise real quick.